So, with that, what we will do in this first session is this is going to be a fun session. Even other sessions will be fun, but this will be fun in the sense no math in this session. You know, the theory of modal is all foundation of ODE, so we will talk about that. Dr. Gupta will talk about that after tea and again after lunch today. But what we will do today, right now in this session, is just show you some really nice videos which will hopefully motivate to you what we are trying to do in this workshop and how the objectives span across domains and the problems are across domains. So, with that, I will start. In fact, I will ask a rhetorical question. So, you know what a rhetorical question is? Hopefully, does everybody know what a rhetorical question is? It is a question that we ask for which we already know the answer. So, I will ask the question and I will list the answer also, but first I will ask it, is what is modal analysis? So, most of you have given us some idea of what you think it is. We will tell you what we think it is. And broadly it kind of agrees with what you say. So, you can take a minute and read this because this is important. The workshop is actually trying to understand through measurements how things respond, and through those measurements we want to build models for whatever you are measuring, because then you can use those models as predictive tools to try and understand how something might behave under test conditions which you have not tested. And so, this is essentially what modal analysis is as per us. And why it is important is already some of you have already mentioned. It has got applications across domains, from foundation to food to damage to perhaps potentially almost everything that you can imagine, because everything in the world vibrates. And at least I think so. And I think that the happy state of most things is to vibrate. And what we need to understand is why it is vibrating, how it is vibrating. And typically the way we characterize vibrations are these three things that we have listed there. The first two you will be familiar with. Most vibrations we characterize by a frequency and an amplitude. The third thing does everybody agree that vibrations have a shape? Have you heard of vibrations having a shape? So, all of you have done the vibration background, either in your undergraduate, some of you are teaching it, some of you are researching on it, right. So, vibrations have a shape. This is something very strange that most people who have not studied cannot wrap their head around. And if you don't believe me, we will show you several videos where you will actually see shape, you will see shapes. So, you can dispel that notion. And of course, the third bullet there is the most important point we want to make in this workshop, is that although we will present a theoretical foundation to understand vibrations, there is absolutely no substitute to measuring. And people who measured know that, people who modeled also know that. There is absolutely no substitute to measure how things vibrate, to try and construct a model from that measurements, and then to use that model for other purposes. So, the objectives or the applications of this are kind of clear. Everything vibrates. There are three things that describe them: frequency, amplitude, shape, and the third thing is there is absolutely no substitute, and we will talk about this a little more detail later. But let us see what why we are interested in modal analysis. So, I will play a few videos, maybe 8-10 slides, and we have turned off the audio, so you can just pay attention to the video. This is a video from, has anybody seen this? Does anybody remember this? So, we have only one person shaking their head. This is a, no, it's not turbulence. This happened last year in an Air Asia flight from somewhere in Southeast Asia to Australia. So, it is looping. And I don't know whether you can see, but hopefully the people at the back, it is clear. This is actually very, very large amplitude vibration. It is not comfortable. This happened last year. It was actually very scary for the passenger sitting inside. Now, some of you might look at the video and say, "Isme kya badi baat hai?" Some of you come by train. So, this happens almost all the time in trains, but in planes, you know, when this happens, it is not good. So, why do you think this is happening? Actually, no, it's not turbulence. Why?
Maybe some bus driver
No, so actually a blade broke. Yeah. A blade on that engine, on one of the engines broke. Yeah. And this is called a blade out. I think they do blade out testing, but this is actually very, very severe. It was a miracle that this did not fall, yeah, and people did not die. Yeah. But there is a reason that that did not happen, and because aircraft and engine manufacturers test for this. So what happens is one of those blades on that engine that you see, it just broke. And this happens, typically it happens in every 2, 3, 5 years of service of the engine. And you need to be able to, the engine needs to be able to withstand that kind of energy that is released when the blade breaks. So if you cannot wrap your head around this, this is that kind, so this is rotating at about I think 3000 RPM somewhere there, typically most engines rotate more. So at that speed, yeah, when the blade breaks, yeah, the energy that is released is equivalent to, I was reading about this last night, is equivalent to a car being raised in the air by about 100, 200 feet, yeah, a medium sized car. That is the kind of energy that is released, which is huge. Yeah. And if that is the kind of energy that is released, the engine casing should not break, because if it breaks, yeah, the plane will get damaged, yeah, and people might die, yeah, and that has happened in the past. But the plane is also very expensive, and that is why one reason people don't want this to happen. So the way they test for this, you think they would test for this, right? You think people test for this? Yeah. How do you think they will test for this? They have to destroy an engine, and they do. Yeah. So almost all engine manufacturers do what is called a blade out test, where they will rotate the engine at very different speeds and at high speeds and at typical loading conditions that the engine sees. And then there'll be a charge on one of those blades, and they will burst it. So the blade will break and shatter. And what the objective of the test is to see whether the engine casing will withstand that. This is an impact. That is one of the objectives of the test, but the other objective of the test, they only test the engine, they don't test the structure. But one of the objectives of any test would be to also understand how the structure will vibrate when there is such kind of imbalance. And you can see this is very large amplitude vibration, right? The structure is become, because the engine is now imbalanced, one blade is less, and that unbalance causes some eccentric loading which excites the structure responds. So you want to know, yeah, how to avoid this. Yeah. So this is one of the reasons why they do what is called ground vibration testing of aircrafts. Yeah. So we will just see a couple of more videos of how they test for this, not really for the engine blade out test, but how they will test structure response to some excitation like this. So can we play this video, please? So this is a student at TUHH, which is a Technical University of Hamburg, Harburg. This is in Hamburg in Germany. And can we just forward the video, Yogendra, thoda, if you can just glide over it. No, back. So you just play the video, and there is a bar at the bottom. So let me just talk you through what he's doing, yeah, and it will become clear as the video progresses. So this is a small plane. Yeah. We have such planes in our flight lab here. Perhaps if we get time, we can take you around to show them. So you can see that the plane is not really kept on the ground. Is that clear to everybody? The plane is suspended. Yeah. So this is called a ground vibration test when the plane is not really on the ground, but it is suspended in chains or in bungees, so rubber strings. And what he is doing, you can see he is going to excite this. So there is what is called an exciter or a shaker. We'll talk more about this later. So what we will do in this session, it will take several leaps. Yeah. Perhaps you've seen the things here they're going to test with, perhaps you've not, but we're going to take several leaps in terms of what you might have already seen. So just go with it, because this is just to motivate your testing what the objective of that test was. So this is a shaker, he's exciting the wing, he's going to put sensors everywhere, he's going to put accelerometers everywhere, and finally what he will get is shapes of vibration. He will excite at different frequencies, and he will do this test on the plane, and he will get not just frequencies, amplitudes, but also shapes. And once he has that, he can construct a mathematical modal model from which he can then predict under different loading conditions how the plane or structure might react. So that is the objective of a test like this. We will do similar tests, not on the plane, but on simplified structures in our labs. So you will see more of this later, but this is just to give you an idea that this is how they test for any kind of excitation that the plane might see. Can we go to the next video again? So this is just data acquisition. This is a little larger, not really a plane, this is just a wing section. So what they are doing again, you can see they are instrumenting and setting it up, and they are going to do two kinds of testing on this. On the first experiment that you saw in the smaller plane was only shaker based excitation. This is going to be shaker plus impact. So with a modal hammer, you give it an impulse load, and because that is a nice transient excitation, everything will vibrate. So you do both kind of experiments. So again, they are just instrumenting the system. You can see these are all sensors, they are mounted everywhere. We will use similar kind of sensors in our labs. We will talk about how they work later. So people are just setting up the test. What you can see in that color changing is actually in a way a shape which is actually measured. So they are going to continue this, and then they will finally, so the objective of this test is to see whether the plane behaves like they've modeled it. So they made a finite element model of this, they did a modal analysis there, and you can see now that the structure of the wing section is being excited, and that it is responding, and then there are sensors everywhere, and then they will do an impact test when it is already being excited, and then this is typically time history of response. That is how it looks, and these are essentially what they are doing. So this is again the same objective. It is not that blade out test testing, but it is to understand how the structure will vibrate to build a mathematical model, and the only way to do that is measure it. So you instrument the entire structure. So this is an impact test what he is doing right now, right? In addition to the shaker excitation, there is an impulse test that they are doing, and then that is the shape. So if you don't believe, this is the shape. Now you have seen, you will also see in the labs. Can we go to the next video? You can. So we will play this. So you saw a small plane, you saw one section. This is a real jet. This is the Embraer that the Brazilian based company makes, and this is also called ground vibration testing. They are going to test the entire structure. This is actually not easy to do. A plane is big, and to test a plane is actually not easy. It requires a lot of instrumentation, a lot of patience, a lot of experiments, a lot of experience. But they are doing a similar kind of test like you saw in the small wing section or you saw in the small plane. These are big shakers now because the plane is big. So the shaker is, we will talk about what it is a little later, like I said, just take leaps right now. A shaker is a modal exciter, it gives force at different frequencies, its working principle can vary. And you just measure acceleration at different locations, either contact type or non-contact type. In non-contact you can measure displacement or velocity, and you can get for one input excitation or for several input excitations, several responses, then construct a mathematical model, get amplitudes, frequencies and shapes. And then once you have this, you are again subjected to different kind of excitation. So that is what they are doing. Again you see these are small sensors put everywhere. These are all accelerometers, all contact type. Now it is being excited. And they actually do these tests, you know, this is not just for a video. This is necessary to do because the plane undergoes all kinds of loading, from excitation because of engine, from random excitation because of wind and turbulence and other kinds of excitation. So all this is being tested for, and again they will show you shapes, but you have already seen them before, so we will forward this. Can we go to the next video? Alright, this is something that Dr. Gupta has done, so actually I will ask him to talk about this. This is a fighter jet testing of some kind. In his previous avatar.
Yeah, so good morning. This is first time formally I am in front of you, and for two slides I am here. One is this, I think there is another one.
The other one.
So you have been seeing like what Mohit was showing, those videos. You have got big aircrafts which are tested to get the what are called as modal parameters, frequencies, dampings and the shapes. And here this is almost a decade old story. When Indian Air Force was just inducting Su-30s, and still we had MiG-29 as a strike fighter. And MiG-29 was developing some problem because of our enthusiastic pilots. That you are seeing that the schematic of fin, and there you are seeing those cross. Right, so these cross, these are the roughly the points where it is connected with the fuselage, and there were a lot of stresses coming here, and in one occasion the entire fin flew off while the pilot was in the air, and he survived. So the problem came to us, and we were trying to understand it. And this problem happens when you have got a fighter plane. For airliner you won't have this problem. Can we go back? Yeah. So here maybe you can see that I have drawn a blue dotted line here. Now in typical airliner you will have a fuselage which is going like this, and you will have a wing which will come out from the fuselage something like this. But in fighter plane, because they don't want to starve of lift at high angle of attack, what is done is that wing starts right after the cockpit and sometimes just below the cockpit. These are called as leading edge extensions. And so that means the wing is not up to this, but it is extended up to this. So it is an extended wing. Now the problem with this extended wing is that at high angle of attack, the vortices, they shed from those leading edge extensions. And if you have the aircraft which has got two fins, there are fighter planes with two fins. MiG-29 is two fins. Tejas aircraft has got one fin. Su-30 has got two fins. So the vortices which are emanating from here, they engulf these two fins. And these two fins are set in the vibratory phenomena called as buffeting. And if you are also pulling out some high G's, then the stresses here are tremendously high. So we were trying to develop the finite element model for the fin so that we can understand where are the hot spots. And towards that, you see that we did model testing. The primary objective of model testing in developing a product is to communicate back and forth between mathematical model and the experimental setup. So in this case, the mathematical model was the finite element model in ANSYS, and we wanted to improve that model. So what you do, that you make a model, go and do the field testing. So we actually stood in front on top of the aircraft, we excited it with the help of hammer, we got the model parameters, and then we fine-tuned our finite element model. So you see that model testing gave us some 14.02 hertz frequency for the first bending mode. ANSYS was giving this much. Ground trial at National Aerospace Lab gave this much, and the flight trial. So in flight measurements were also done. So you see that there is a quite good agreement. So that makes us confident on the finite element model which we developed. So so model testing plays a very important role in developing finite element model if you want to analyze existing product or you want to improve on the existing product. If you are starting ab initio the new product, you really don't have anything to experiment with. But what you can do, you can build a prototype into it. Now the second one, so this is two decade old story. So Kirloskar Copeland, they are in the business of making industrial grade refrigerators, and for that they need compressor. You all have seen in your refrigerator such type of compressor behind, right? It is hermetically sealed, it is in two parts, there is some reciprocating part which pumps gas, so on. So they made a finite element model, but they did not have the vibration testing facility those days. So they approached us, and we did the measurement. We will tell you how this model testing is done. Some of you already know it. So this is what is the graphical representation of the points where the measurement was taken, and the body of the compressor was excited with the help of hammer, and we found out different modes of vibration. So in this particular mode, you see that the top plate, which is the top plate here, which is undergoing bending vibration. So, the center point of the plate goes up and down harmonically. In fact, this is also coupled with the longitudinal vibration of the entire shell. And in this particular mode, we will tell you at some stage that there are, as Mohit was saying you, there are shapes of vibrations. These are the shapes of vibration which we are obtaining from model tests. So, this is one of those asymmetric modes of vibration. So, then this helped them to validate their finite element model. So, these are, you know, few examples where we used model testing, and so this is what we are sharing with you. And now I'll give the command back to Mohit.
Thanks.
In fact, we will talk a little more about testing of planes on Thursday. We have one invited speaker, Dr. Madhusudan from the Aeronautical Development Agency in Bangalore, where he will actually talk about what they also do in ground vibration testing of, I think, is it the Tejas, Shakti?
Yeah.
So, that in fact, even I am eager to learn about, yeah, because these are just videos that we see, but I have also not seen plane testing yet. So, that should be interesting. So, anyway, what we have only spoken about so far is testing of planes. But this is a problem not just for planes, but also for a structure like this. Can we play this video? So, this is something perhaps you are also familiar with. Have people seen this video before, what this structure is? Tacoma. So, this is a famous or infamous bridge which was made in the 1940s. And this is a nice video to motivate what we are trying to do. So, you can see this has got really, really large amplitude vibration. This is not supposed to happen. Have you seen bridges vibrate like this? They are not supposed to, right? And why do you think this is happening? Yes, yeah, so one reason is wind based excitation, random, because wind is random. Yes, so you are exciting one of the, not one, there are several modes that are being excited. So, there is, in modal there is not just, because everything in the world is continuous, it is not discrete lumped parameter system. So, there are several modes and it is exciting, the wind is exciting, is random, so it can excite any modes. You can see these are combination of complex mode shapes, some are torsion, some are bending, and it is broadband excitation, and clearly you can see what happens to this bridge over time. It will actually fall. And this is a very famous or infamous example of how not to design bridges. They should be designed for broadband excitation, the support systems or the cables or things like that. You should know how to do this. So, very strange people are walking on it, I don't know why. It is just about to fall. But there are strange people everywhere in the world, not just in India. This is somewhere in the US. Yeah. Okay, so it is just going to fall after he walks out, yeah, and we'll just watch that and then we'll go to the next slide. Yeah.
It's so strange that the car is not moving. There is a car.
Yes, so car is on. So can anybody understand why the car is not moving?
That is a nodal point.
So there is something called a nodal point where there is no response. So if you stand there or somebody else stands or you put anything there, it will not move. But everywhere else there is a response, so that is interesting, and we will see this in our measurements. You will see there are nodal locations. So now it has fallen, clearly that is not a good thing. So you would think we would learn and we would design bridges after this. Yogendra, can we go? So we would learn from that, and let's play this video. And this is the video is not playing for some reason. Okay, so this is a schematic or an animation of a mode shape done in FE, finite element code. Again, they are using ANSYS like Dr. Gupta did many years ago. So, you can also do model analysis there, and because it is very difficult to build a bridge, to test it and then to change design. So, this should inform the way you should make a bridge. So, you would think that people have learned, they know how to do FE analysis, they know, they have learned from the disaster of Tacoma in 1940s, and that they would build a bridge that will not break or that will not really vibrate. So, let us see what people have learned. Can we go to the next slide? That's a similar kind of bridge as Tacoma. It's a suspension bridge. The next slide. Can we play the video? So you know this. Has anybody seen this video before? Yes, you've seen. Where is this? This is in the UK. This was called the Millennium Bridge. It opened in the year in the 2000 years. That's why it's called Millennium Bridge. And you can see what is happening again. Is there a large amplitude vibration? Why is this happening? Again, you can see there is very strong wind blowing. Those things you can see moving around, fluttering. But also people are walking, and that is also broadband excitation. So for both reasons, the bridge is actually this is actually very large amplitude vibration for a bridge. This should not happen. So this is the day that the bridge opened. The AC has come off, come on. So can you hear me at the back? Can you hear me at the back? So I have to speak for 5 days. So I would request that you please, in the next session, you please come forward, because otherwise I will lose my voice. I have to teach the week after that also. Okay, so next session mein please aage aa jaiye. Okay, so this is can we go back? I didn't want to play that. Okay, so let's play this video. Let's finish the story first. Okay, so this is you think people would have learnt from the Tacoma disaster and from doing FE analysis of how to build a bridge, and the bridge should not have such vibrations, but apparently they have not. This was the first day of its opening. The day it opened, the day the bridge was inaugurated in the year 2001, I think January 1st is when this happened. So what they had to do is then shut down the bridge, because clearly had they let this continue, it could fall. And then they designed, they measured the bridge, and then they designed I think a combination of active and passive damping solutions to try and minimize this large amplitude vibration, and now the bridge is proper. But you think that they would test and build, but which is always not very easy to do in bridges. So let's see the next video, which is actually a test bridge. Can we play this? Okay, so this is a real bridge. It is not being built for a test. You can see that these people, so what they will do is they will excite the bridge, and so this is harmonics or different modes of vibration. We'll talk about detail of all this, but you can clearly see they're exciting the bridge, and the bridge is vibrating. There is a shape of vibration, and what is interesting now is you will see somebody running into the video. So this is a nice shape, right? This is the bending motion. This is their professor who has just run into the video. This is he is their professor, and you see he is also helping excite. This is not a bridge which was built for the purpose of testing. This is just a bridge which they, I think, happened across. And you will see that they can then, so this video goes on. We will share these videos with you. You can watch them later. And they do really nice excitation. You will see them do torsion excitation. This is the, now they are discussing where to excite. So this is a high frequency mode, you will see.
This is like a real steel
bridge? This is not steel, this is wood with, I suppose, the sides are also wood. And it has got a suspension, you can see in the top. So this is a cable suspension, it looks like. So this is a high frequency bending mode. And if you let this continue, they will do torsion, and we'll just watch one torsion mode, and then we will leave this. But you can't build bridges like this to test them. This is not a modal test. But this is a nice example of how you would do a modal test. You will excite, and you will measure, and you will see these things. Okay, so this is Shiroli has left, but this is what question she had asked. Anti-node. Anti-node is when there is no response, anti-node where there is response. So you can see now there are several locations in this bridge where there is no vibration or no response. So this is kind of interesting. This is much higher frequency. It's like they're having fun. So that's why I said this session is going to be a little fun, even the session after this. For some reason I can't forward, so we'll just wait till we watch the torsion mode. That's really interesting. This is an old video. This is probably 60s, 70s, I don't know when. It looks like made in that era.
Looks like
They've not made the bridge for this testing, right? It looks very strange. This is very interesting. This is a torsion mode. This is the mode that you saw the Tacoma bridge that was undergoing, a mode like this torsion. Anyway, so this goes on and on, and if you did not believe my statement in the beginning that vibrations have shapes, you can clearly see that shapes are real. Yeah? You can measure them with fancy sensors and excitation, or you can just, if you have a setup like this, you can also see shapes. Yeah? Okay, so not just bridges. Yeah?
But this kind of experimental type of work is possible for the stiffer material. If you think about the civil point of view,
yes,
it is RCC.
Yes, it is possible.
It's obviously a rigid material.
No, actually, so one block of RCC might be rigid, but the structure is not, and you will see that. Yeah? So, okay, so this is just a different video. So, can we play this? So, this is your question now. Yeah? So, this is, so it is not just for planes, for bridges, but also for buildings.
RCC.
Yeah, so this is a steel frame building. So, I don't know if you can see, this is actually really, really large amplitude vibration. This is real during an earthquake somewhere in Japan. Okay, this is, can you see at the back?
Yeah.
That this is actually very, really large amplitude. Yeah? This should not happen. And if I was in this building, I would be scared. Yeah? But this building has been designed not to fall for such large amplitude vibration under earthquakes. And the way you would design this, so you can all, everybody can see this, right? This is actually very, very large amplitude. And the way you will test and design this, you can't build a building like this, so you will build a small schematic. Can we press play? So on the left is something that is supposed to be a building, multi-floor. And on the right is the same thing, but with something that absorbs the vibration. So, this is a vibration absorber or a vibration isolation mechanism, those cylinders there. Yeah. And this is also, you can test this, you can do a modal test to figure out where to put the sensors, where the structure should be damped. And you can clearly, if you can't hear me at the back, you know, next session you have to come forward. Okay, because I'll lose my voice otherwise. Yeah. Okay, so this is how they also test for buildings. I have a few more videos, but I've, can we play this? Oh. This I really like actually. Is it clear to you that there is a shape and that's an impact? Yeah. So I play tennis and that is why I'm interested in this. Yeah. Because most good tennis rackets in the world, yeah, and this is a, I think a Babolat or a Head racket, which is a good company. Almost all of them do modal analysis on their sport equipment, yeah, because it is impact. And that impact is a shock to your arm. And you want to understand how to design the racket, what the influence of tensioning on the strings is, what the influence of positioning a small damper on the racket is in terms of transmission of shock to your arm, which is nothing but you do a modal test, right? So this is not a modal test, but you can do a modal test. This is the real modal test of a racket. This is a tennis racket. These are the same grid points that Dr. Gupta showed you. This is the measurement grid. You put sensors everywhere. You excite it and you can see that there is a nice shape. Yeah? The strings move in one direction and the frame moves in the other. And you can now use this information to understand influence, what will happen when you excite somewhere else, what its kind of behavior will be. Hmm? You think we can do this for other kind of sporting equipment? You think people do it? You think you can do it? What about for a bat? Has anybody done it? I don't know. Yeah? But you think it's important for a bat?
Yes, sir.
Why? You think there is a shape in wood? Mr. Himanshu from that company says no. Yeah?
Sir,
he says yes. Yeah?
Bat, high stiffness and heavy.
So what?
In respect of the ball.
The building is high stiffness, bridge is high stiffness. This frequency will be higher. Because omega n is k by m, square root of. Not necessarily, not necessarily. That's never true. It depends on the structure. And we will show you, we will see experiments where that's not true.
Different parts. Behind the back portion, we can try to modal it.
I don't know. Has anybody, I have not done it. Yeah? But if somebody is interested, it still might be an interesting experiment because I don't think that just because it is stiff it will not vibrate. It will vibrate, maybe amplitude will be small, it will have a shape, it will have some damping. Wood is a very good damping material, and wood is horribly difficult actually because it is anisotropic, so its behavior is very difficult to model. So perhaps the only way you can do is measure. But you think they do this for badminton rackets? You think they do this for golf sticks? It is done. So golf sticks, they do modal analysis, you know golf, right? It's this strange sport where you hit the ball and then you run after it, right? In most other sports like cricket or soccer or anything else, the ball you hit, somebody else goes after it. But golf is you hit and then you go. But golf, maybe they do modal analysis of their sticks, and that is necessary, yeah? Because again you want to understand impact. And then you can use that information to design a better golf stick, or what are they called? Clubs, golf clubs. Yeah? Okay, all right. So this, you think they would do modal analysis of a musical instrument? Understandably, clearly, and you do this because sometimes vibrations are good in this example, but what is the influence of body, material, bridge location, string stiffness? Can also be experimentally measured, and this is an experimental shape, yeah? These are different shapes, these are all experimental. This is not a ANSYS model, yeah? You can see this is animated more shapes from experimental data. Somebody else has done, we have not done. But it is possible to get a sense of how even musical instruments vibrate, again for the purpose of perhaps designing them better. Yeah. So it's not always to mitigate vibration, it is sometimes to get better vibrations for selective processes. Also modal, you can see nice different shapes. This is something very interesting. If you still don't believe that vibrations have shapes, can we play? Okay. Has anybody heard of Chalny patterns before? Yeah. You've seen Chalny patterns? We will do a lab on this. So you will see, we will do a lab. So this is actually very impressive, and I will not spoil the surprise, but what we will do in the lab will be even more impressive. So you will see tomorrow afternoon. So what they are doing is, this is a plate, yeah, mounted on a shaker, the same kind of shaker that you use to excite the planes, yeah, and they are just changing the frequency of excitation. The shaker is below the plate, and you can see. So why does this is salt, why does it go and settle on these patterns? This is again Shiroli, your answer, your question.
Yeah, I was assuming that something related.
There is no response at those locations, so it all goes and settles over there. So that's the nodal line or nodal circle. So everywhere else where it is black, there is vibration. Everywhere where there is no vibration is where the particles will go and settle. And we will do this experiment tomorrow on a plate. We will not do salt because for some reason in our collective sensibilities it is not good to sprinkle salt, right? People think it is not good to sprinkle salt, right? At least in India. So we will do it with sand, but we will do something even more impressive than this. So I will not spoil the surprise, you will see tomorrow. But this is really nice, yeah. So you see it, right? That's why people don't believe that vibrations have shapes unless you see. So that's why we will show you, and we will show you how to do the experiment. Okay, all right. This just goes on and on. This is a lovely video to watch. Yeah? Can we play this? So for people who are interested in automotive, there were some people here working on, I think, chassis, or somebody was speaking about this. You can also do the same thing that you did for planes and for buildings and for bridges on cars, and this is typically done. I don't know if any Indian car automaker is doing this, but they all want to do it. They all want to do it. They want to mount all their cars on shakers, and the reason they want to do this is because, you know, we have very bad roads in India, and they're all kind of different profile of loading. So it's a case of base vibration, base excitation. In fact, those people are very interested because they make filters for which are supposed to withstand this kind of base excitation. So we will also show you how to do this kind of experiment, not on a car but on a single degree of freedom system. where we will excite the base. It's called a transmissibility experiment, where you will excite the ground or the base and you will measure response on a some other location, and we will change excitation and we will see how it responds accordingly. But if you can do that, so let me just emphasize this. The kind of ideas we are trying to motivate in this course over the next 5 days are going to be universal. We will not apply them to a car or a plane or to a building, because we can't do that in a course. But what we will motivate, the principles of those are universal across all domains, and they are the same ideas which you can translate to test bigger real structures. So take that message away, that our focus here is on the fundamentals, and to demonstrate to you how to test objects, how to instrument, how to measure, and you use that information then for testing and doing whatever else you want to do. Okay, so all right. This is my domain of interest. This is machine tools. So this is what you see. This is a small shaker again, and this is a response function. We'll talk more about this today and again in the evening today. This is output input. This is output. There is some non-contact sensor somewhere measuring response. This is called a frequency response function. So you're sweeping, and you can excite the. This is a tool. For those for who it is not clear, this is a milling tool. There is a spindle and there is a full machine behind that. You can excite this using shakers or even using hammers. We will do both. You will do both labs in this course, and you will get similar responses. So this is what we mean. So each of these peaks is a frequency. The width is in a sense damping or amplitude, and each of these peaks has a shape which you have to measure several points to get. But this is just to show you that this can also be applied to real machines. This is a similar thing, but in the finite element domain. So this is again a modal analysis. You apply a load, you solve the eigenvalue problem, which is nothing but the equation of motion, and you get eigenvectors and eigenvalues, which is nothing but shape. This is not very difficult to do, and we'll talk about how to do this. We will not talk about FE in this course, because this is not about modal analysis using FE. This is ideas of modal analysis, the fundamentals of vibration and testing, so experimental modal analysis. But this is not difficult to do. If you can do what we will do in this course, you can also do this. Okay, so good. This is one of the coolest videos I have for today. So this is a video that is shot by people in MIT. It's called visual vibrometry. So can you just pause this video? So in all the other experiments and videos you have seen, we are normally measuring with a contact type sensor. You mount the sensor onto the structure, or you measure using non-contact in terms of a laser vibrometer or some other principle of measuring non-contact. But this is kind of interesting, because what this does is modal analysis. This is actually modal analysis using image processing. So you record a video and you excite the structure using broadband excitation. In this case, you will see what he does. And once you get modal properties of this structure, so damping, shape and frequency, you can then do very interesting things with this. So I have a couple of students who are working on this, and we've actually done something even better, but we'll not talk about that. But this is actually very cool. Can we play this? So he's just recording video. So this is modal analysis using image processing. And now he will excite the object by just hammering the table in which this is kept on, and it will vibrate. He will capture that motion through video, and then he will do a little image processing and get frequency, damping and shape. So you can't really see it vibrating, maybe a little you can see, right? This is very flexible setup. It's deliberate. It's just to test ideas. Okay, now this will continue, and what he will do is extract modal parameters, wo ho gaya, and then he will use that to test how this can respond to different kind of excitation. So this is what he is doing. So he can make this do whatever he wants to do now. This is not what he did, right? But in a way, what he has done is extracted a mathematical model, so shape, frequency and amplitude, and now he is exciting different methods using it. This is actually very, very impressive. But we are also doing something similar. I will not talk about that. It's actually very exciting. We can talk about this in detail later, but this is a really cool application of modal analysis, and I think this is the future. That is why I am showing you this, because all you have to do is take a camera, point, shoot, run an image processing algorithm on your smartphone app, and that's done. No hammer, no shaker. Of course, you need all that also in the background. You still, there is theory in it. It's the theory of modal analysis. All that is happening in the background, so you still need to do that. But perhaps this might be the future. So that's why I wanted to show. This is what these chaps are using it for, computer graphics in Hollywood. Yeah. Their application is not structural testing. Their application is something else, but it's a very interesting idea, and that's why I wanted to share this. So this is really interesting. They can just measure anything through image processing, excite it any which way, and see how it responds. Okay, so we will share the links for this. You can go watch at your own time. All right. So this Dr. Gupta already spoke about. I will quickly conclude in another 2-3 slides what this session is about. So this is in a way what we have kind of discussing, the applications of modal analysis, and the range or the spectrum of application ranges from just measuring to understand how something vibrates, to wanting to validate a numerical or finite element model, or wanting to do damage detection or structural health monitoring or condition monitoring to see how things change over time. So all those are applications of modal analysis, but the underlying philosophy is what? You measure, extract a mathematical model. That is the underlying philosophy of this course also, is you measure to get a mathematical model, then you can use that for any application you want to use, right? So that is what this course is about. All right. These are very important things for us. These are the three basic assumptions or three pillars on which the foundation of modal analysis is based, and these are all assumptions. If we don't make these assumptions, it is very difficult for us to do anything else. So these assumptions are very simple. The first one states that the structure is linear. That means it is not non-linear. That means there is no geometric nonlinearity, there is no material nonlinearity. It is a linear structure, and linear structure which we can describe using second order ODEs, ordinary differential equations. You industry people might have forgotten all this, but we will revise your memory. Almost everybody else is teaching or is doing this, so they know what this is. But that is the first very important assumption for us, that the structure is linear. And by linear, I also mean that if I change level of excitation, the response will change in proportion, right? So if I input with some level of force excitation, some magnitude, the response will be some magnitude, and if I increase the magnitude, the response will increase linearly. It's not a non-linear system, right? So this is the first important assumption for us, without which we can't proceed. The second one is what is called reciprocity, or Maxwell's reciprocity. It means that if you have a structure of interest, if this is your structure of interest, if you excite at this location and you measure at this location, it is the same thing if you excite here and measure here. And we'll talk about how in the fundamental basis of this again later. But this is important for us, because if this is, the structure is linear, structure has to be linear for this to hold. Right, that's why the first assumption is structure is linear, and second it is reciprocity is true. And this is useful for us, because at many times we can't always measure everywhere, or we can't excite everywhere the structure. Why this assumption? If the structure is linear, the structure, nothing in the world is linear. I'm asking about reciprocity. So only if the structure is linear will this be true, right? If the structure is not linear, if I excite here and measure here, There is no guarantee that it is the same thing that if I excite here and measure here, right? For linear structures, for linear structures, but most structures in the world are not linear. Machines to a small extent are linear, but if you change level of excitation, it is no longer linear. All joints are non-linear. So, all interfaces are non-linear, they all have friction, friction is a non-linearity. So, it is the assumption that structure is linear, right, and that is why reciprocity is true. The third thing is little confusing. We are saying structure is time invariant. Do you understand what that means? We are talking about vibrations, that means something is changing over time. So, response is changing over time. So, what do we mean by time invariant? It is a time varying response, that is what a vibration is, a response is. So, what do you think we mean by time invariance here? Properties, structural properties, material properties, structural properties do not change over time. You can apply modal analysis to the case where structure is changing over time, in which case it becomes a linear time varying system. We are doing what is called LTI, linear time invariant system, because this is the introduction level course, but if you want and you have applications where the structure is actually changing, we can talk about that separately. You can extend the ideas of what we will do in that case, but in for our discussions for the next 5 days, we are going to assume that these three things are true, and that is why it makes these things life easier for us. If these things are not clear, you will not perhaps understand and follow the rest of the thing. So, if you have a question, ask now. No question about these three basic assumptions? Composite is not linear system. It is not valid. That is true. But people even then do linear modal analysis of composites, and that is why when you see results, you have to always ask a question. Have you tested for these three? Does it obey reciprocity? Does the response change as the input changes? In the sense, if you give say 10 Newton input sinusoidal and the response is say 1 millimeter, if you make it 20 Newton, it should be proportional. But if it is not, that suggests that the structure is not linear and composites are not linear. So, clearly you should test for it. Under some narrow regime, it is possible it is linear, but in general it is not.
Sir, can we relate to for mode, say, first mode, second mode?
Yes. This is the basis of modal analysis. We are assuming linearity. Only then we can do modal analysis, we can get eigenvectors. Eigenvectors are just scaled. They are just shapes which are scaled, and we talk about how to get them later. But the assumption is, if it is, because it is linear, those are just scaled. If it is not linear, you can't do that, right? You can't even solve the eigenvalue problem so easily. So, this is a very basic assumption for us, very important for us. But fortunately for us, most of the systems we are interested in the range of operating conditions we are interested in, structures behave linearly, or you can approximate their behavior to be linear. And that for us makes life simpler. For example, buildings are not linear, bridges are not linear, but in the range that we are interested in, they are kind of linear, so you can make that assumption safely.
As a component is subjected to the variant of temperature,
yes.
As the temperature changes, so the stiffness of the body
changes.
Yes. How can we guarantee about mode shifts?
You can't. You can't. Because now you see the third assumption is being validated, is being invalidated, right? Because it is now changing. So if property is changing, you have to test at range of temperatures to get understanding of how it behaves over range of temperatures.
So we have to conduct several tests at different temperatures.
Yes.
Finding out the
mode shifts. If I was you, I would do that, and that's not difficult, right? That's what his question was. So, there is something actually, no, we are talking about structural modal analysis. There is also something called thermal modal analysis, which we are not talking about, right? But which is a very interesting, very similar kind of idea. You can construct similar where you can get a thermal mode shape, which is actually, and there are two kinds of mode shapes, the transient and the steady state, even in thermal. But that's a very different problem. We're not going to talk about it here. We're going to limit our discussions to only structural modal analysis. If you're interested in thermal modal analysis, we can talk about it outside later. Yeah.
This may not be a much more emphasis on the structures which are having an influence of dynamics of soil particles.
You mean boundary conditions are influencing?
Time variant may be there or properties may going to change.
True.
Because soil is not a homogeneous body.
No.
Because stress strain characteristics.
But it's a boundary condition, right? It's how you model that boundary condition.
Yeah.
If you model that boundary condition to be linear within a given range, you can use these ideas. So this is interesting because this is a very important discussion for us. These three assumptions are the basis of everything else we will do. Yeah?
So suppose there is a orthotropic composite cantilever beam, will it follow these three assumptions?
The composite beam, they want to know if it is going to follow these three assumptions. Yeah? And I would think not. So geometric nonlinearity agar absent hai. There was the same question earlier, so I hope this addresses it. Yeah, as in the given operating conditions, if your system is linear, then you can use the ideas we're going to motivate. And for most of our structures, we are typically operating in the linear range, or we assume it to be linear within a given range, or we assume linear boundary conditions, and that is why you can do this. Okay, good. All right. There is one other very important thing in modal analysis, and it is called domain decomposition. So this is something some of you might have seen, might not have seen. So we measure in the time domain always. We excite and we measure, we excite something as a function of time. We measure response as a function of time. Doesn't matter what the response is, whether it is acceleration, displacement or velocity. Is always time history is what you are measuring, but modal is in the modal domain. Which is a combination of frequency and modal. So there is natural frequency, there is damping and there is eigenvector. So that is the typically the modal or frequency domain. So you can do what is called a domain decomposition. You can go from time, so experiments are in time or experiments can be converted to modal frequency. And you can talk to domains within each other. You can do domain decomposition, and that is what is interesting about this modal thing. And you can also reconstruct a physical model or a spatial model where you have MC and K, which is different than the modal mass, modal stiffness, modal damping, using what is called domain decomposition. So, and but all this assumes linearity, reciprocity and invariance, because Dr. Gupta will talk about this and I will also talk about this later. It assumes orthogonality of eigenvectors. So only when that is all true can you do these domain decomposition. There is also a third domain which is called the state space domain, which some of you might have seen before, especially the ones of you who are dealing with control. You can also talk about modal being decomposed into state space or time going to state space, and you can talk to each domain. So this domain decomposition where you have a model in one domain and you can transform to another domain is also what makes modal analysis interesting for us. Okay, right. So we are going to do this domain decomposition. We are going to go from time to frequency using Fourier ideas, okay? And we talk about that Fourier analysis, and we can go from modal to spatial using orthogonality of eigenvectors. So that is also a domain decomposition, one domain to another. And on Thursday, we'll talk about how to go from modal to state space, or from spatial to state space, when we'll talk about system identification. And these are just different domains depending on what you want to do, yeah? What your application is. You can talk and you can convert from one model domain to another. So this is important for us. One more thing I will leave you with before we break for tea is this. Yeah? So what we're actually going to do in this course is we are going to measure, right? So we measured here, that is the experiment, and we've got what is called now a response model. So this is what our input is. We are going to get a response model, which is a description between input and output. But response model has very little information that we are interested in. We are interested in frequency, damping, and shape. So we will build from a response model a modal model. And because we can do domain decomposition, where if orthogonality holds, we can then go from modal to spatial. So this is the real problem, right? This is the way we actually want to go, where we measure in time, time histories, we go to response, from there you go to modal, from there you go to spatial, and then use that for other purposes that you want to do. Because FE, for example, is in what domain? Is a numerical domain, but it is in spatial, physical mass, physical stiffness, right? So in case you have that, but you're doing some experimental validation or verification of your models, you need to go to that domain, yeah? From measurements, time, to frequency, to modal, to spatial. But the way we will motivate this course is we will do the reverse problem. Yeah? So we will start, because it's easier for us to explain how these things happen. The way we will structure this course or this workshop is we will start with the spatial domain. From there we will go to modal, and from there we'll build a response model. Right? That is, it's called the forward problem, but we're actually interested in this reverse problem. But we start with the forward problem because it helps understand the fundamental basis of modal analysis, how you go from single degree to multi-degree to modal, and from modal to frequency, response function. That is what we want to do, and that is what we're going to do. So today and tomorrow is essentially going to be the forward process. So in the session after tea, Dr. Gupta will start with spatial modeling. And then we'll talk about modal and frequency today and tomorrow. Yes. So just to understand, this is the real what we're actually interested in. This comes from measurements, time histories, but we will do this because it is easier to explain and for you to understand what is happening. Yeah? Okay. The way we structured this course is there are three broad modules. The first module is the theoretical basis, is the spatial and the modal and the frequency response, which Dr. Gupta will start with, yeah? And I will talk a little about. There is a second module, which is the measurement considerations, in which we will talk about how to go from time to frequency in using Fourier. So that's Fourier analysis, which Dr. Sharma might not talk about, so we'll get somebody else, maybe Dr. Wahi sitting there. All right, so we'll talk about that later, but Dr. Sharma was supposed to do this, but he is busy with something else, so we'll get somebody else to help us with this. There are plenty of people here. This advantage of IIT Kanpur also for you people, in case you do not know, one of the strengths of the mechanical engineering department is actually dynamics. So there are a lot of people who are actually very good at this, and they're all going to help us contribute to making, to delivering this workshop. So tomorrow we will also talk about measurement considerations, where we will talk about different kind of excitation mechanisms, from shakers to hammers. We'll talk about how sensors work, we'll talk about how shakers work, we'll talk about where you place shaker, where you place sensor, observability, controllability. We'll spend a lot of time on what is called DSP, which is digital signal processing, which is how you will acquire data. We'll talk a little about how to go from analog to digital, because all signals are analog, but we process data digitally. We'll spend a lot of time on that because that is very important, from measurements, how to construct models. And if that step is wrong, then everything else is wrong. And then on the third and fourth and fifth days, we'll talk about system identification, which is once you have measurements, how do you make a response model? From the response model, how do you get modal parameters? And from modal parameters, how do you get spatial parameters? We'll talk about system identification in the frequency domain as well as the time domain, so two different methods. Dr. Suparno Mukhopadhyay from the civil engineering department will talk about time, I'll talk about frequency. And we will have one external expert speaker, that is Dr. Madhusudan. I already mentioned from the ADA, Aeronautical Development Agency in Bangalore, where he will talk about ground vibration testing of aircraft. And of course, this is not possible without the support of our, I've written army, because it's actually an army. It's 16 to 20 people who are going to help us do these experiments. There'll be a lot of experiments. You have the schedule. We'll make groupings tomorrow, not today, because labs will start tomorrow, not today. We need to do a little things in class so you can explain, understand what we will do in lab. So today and tomorrow till afternoon is classroom session, and tomorrow afternoon after lunch is lab. This is the structure of the workshop. All of you have a copy of this, so I will not spend time on this. But this is essentially a little more detailed what session we're going to do, and this is also pasted outside. All classroom sessions will be here. Labs will be all over the campus, so we will escort you around. You don't have to worry. There will be a workshop dinner on Thursday evening, a gala dinner where you can interact not just with each other more informally, but with also the department. So if you have other questions which you think we have not addressed, some of our colleagues will be there and you can also talk to them. It's a good way to interact with what is happening in our department, the mechanical engineering department. That's on Thursday evening. And this is the last slide before tea. We started at 9:10, so we'll finish at 10:40. So this is the question I ask a lot of people. Some people know the answer, so don't answer it. What is the best model of a cat? And this is not a trivial question. This is a very important question for us. And this sounds like a very strange question, but it's very important. So let's try what you think is the best model of a cat. Anybody? Somebody? Cat? Billy?
Through image processing.
Model of a cat? Image processing? No. What is the best model of a cat? Partial there, PDEs.
Persian cat.
Persian cat. No, that's one cat. What is the best model of a Persian cat? Cat is not a single degree of freedom system.
It's like a lump mass system.
No. So, I am asking this question for a reason. Yeah? Does anybody know the answer? Try, what is the best model of a cat? Jumping? No, that is what the cat does. Car? Oh, wow. So, I want you guys to think a little more simply, is what we are trying to motivate. Think a little more simply. And I ask this question, so I teach this course in modal analysis, and my students can answer this. So, no. So, I will submit, because you guys are taking time and because maybe you are want tea, I certainly need tea. So, I will submit that the best model of a cat is another cat, or preferably the same cat. Do you understand why I am asking this question and what I am trying to get at? So, the best model of a cat I am writing there now is another cat, or preferably the same cat, which is another way to say what is written at the bottom. So, let us read that. That there is absolutely no substitute to the way, if you want to understand how things vibrate, is to measure them. And to measure them, you will do modal analysis to understand and build a mathematical model. So, the point of asking that question is that if you want to understand how something behaves, the model is useful sometimes, but there is no substitute to measuring. So please remember this, we will ask this question again, what the best model of a cat is, and it is the same cat. So measure, yeah, and measure. Good. So we'll break for tea.